There's a problem with the way we talk about glaciers.
The loss of glaciers and the melting of the ice.
There will be sea level rise, changes in ocean circulation, mass movement of peoples.
Another pressure on water supplies.
2 billion people are at risk.
As true as those statements are, they just don't always land. Most of us live nowhere near a glacier and may have never even seen one. Glaciers feel like a distant concept, isolated to the harshest and most remote reaches of our planet. But they affect all of us much more than we might realize. Everyone knows that the glaciers are melting, but how could we possibly understand the significance of losing them without first understanding the importance of having them? So let's visit some glaciers, follow their meltwater all the way to the ocean, and see all of the vital roles that it plays along the way, from the high alpine to lush rainforests, to bustling cities. Let's better understand these massive chunks of ice for what they are. Not a distant concept, but the beating heart of our entire planet. All right, before we go talk about the importance of glaciers, I want to tell you about something that's really important for my process as a filmmaker. Sound design. This video is sponsored by Epidemic Sound. If you're a longtime viewer here, you'll know that Epidemic Sound and I go way back. We've done a bunch of fun projects together, and they've been my source for all of my sound effects for the last 5 years now. Their library is huge, like 90,000 sound effects huge. So no matter what obscure sound I'm looking for, this is where I go. Like, here's the sound design in the intro you just watched. They also have a ton of great music, and one of my favorite features is that you can download the individual stems. With the music in this video, I'm constantly tweaking the stems to make sure it fits just right with what I'm showing you. And for the record, you're not going to get a copyright strike on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram. No matter where you're posting, they have you covered. All of the music in this video is from Epidemic Sound, so listen closely, and if you like what you hear, you can use the link in the description of this video to get a 30-day free trial of either a personal or commercial plan. It's thanks to sponsors like Epidemic Sound that I can go on these trips making these videos without sinking into a deep pit of financial ruin in the process. So, thank you again, and now let's go put on our Crocs. You'll see why.
Nice.
That was good.
So here's start of our river. Bunch of glaciers up here in the mountains, melting. Bunch of cascades down this cliff. And starting this little river, which will follow all the way out to the ocean. Incredible landscape in here. Feels very alive.
This region is Washington's North Cascades, the most glaciated part of the contiguous United States, and an area that does a great job showing how glaciers fit into a larger system. Glaciers cover about 10% of the Earth's land area, all of it either close to the poles or at high elevations, the only parts of the world with the right conditions for a glacier to form. So let's say it snows a lot in the winter, and the summer isn't long or hot enough to melt it all away. Each year, more and more snow builds up, eventually becoming heavy enough to be compressed into ice under its own weight, then heavy enough to start sliding downhill. Now you have a glacier, a huge mass of ice slowly moving across the ground. The way glaciers form makes them an indispensable tool for research. Each layer of a glacier contains samples of water, air, and dust from the year that snow fell, perfectly preserved in the ice. And the further down you go, the older the ice gets. It contains records of past changes in the Earth's climate, but also volcanic eruptions, lead from Iron Age smelting, and radioactivity from the rise of nuclear testing. Biological time capsules offering a glimpse into tens of thousands of years of history. Naturally, having a big block of ice here keeps this area cool, but it also helps keep the entire planet cool. Ice on the Earth's surface reflects the sun, regulating climate.
Pretty cool.
Keeping the immediate area cool is incredibly beneficial for local ecosystems like alpine meadows. The species living here are highly sensitive, relying on cold air and water from the glacier to survive. Cooling from the glacier supports these species, but it also keeps other ones out. Larger trees could easily overtake this landscape, guzzling the water supply, replacing smaller vegetation, making the area less biodiverse and more vulnerable to wildfire. But cooler temperatures and longer summer snowpack keep trees out. The same goes for alpine lakes. Glacial meltwater provides the cold water and nutrients required to keep these small but biodiverse ecosystems alive. In these more sensitive subalpine ecosystems, you'll often notice these smaller streams of glacial meltwater flowing through the area. Follow those streams downhill, and pretty quickly you'll see them combine to form a much larger river flowing through an old-growth temperate rainforest. We can't see the glacier anymore, but its effects are still felt all throughout this forest. During the fall and winter, heavy rainfall keeps these rivers going, and in the spring, seasonal snowmelt does the same. But in the late summer, the snow's melted, the rain hasn't started yet, and things get dicey. That's where the glaciers come in, acting as a natural reservoir and releasing over 700 billion liters of water each summer, keeping these rivers flowing. Like this one, the Nooksack River. During the summer, anywhere between 60 and 95% of this water comes straight from the glaciers above. The water is still freezing cold, vital for countless species of plants, insects, and fish, including some of the healthiest salmon runs in North America. The exact same thing happens during more extreme weather events. During a drought or a heat wave, these glaciers will supply more water and help keep the landscape afloat. But these glaciers don't just support hundreds of species of plants and animals. They also support us. Further downstream, the edge of this river is lined with farms taking advantage of that same summer meltwater, helping the Northwest to grow hundreds of agricultural products, generating over 300,000 jobs and more than 13% of the area's economy. Summer meltwater can also be used to generate hydropower, dammed and stored in reservoirs until the winter when demand for heat and electricity is highest.
So this glacier here feeds this stream, which then flows into this dammed reservoir.
The Pacific Northwest generates half of the United States' hydropower, thanks in large part to its glaciers. Glacier-fed reservoirs are also a source of drinking water. Glaciers are often referred to as ecological water towers, storing 75% of the Earth's freshwater and supplying drinking water to 2 billion people. Here in the Northwest, there are three large cities right next to the mountains with millions of people living in them. Seattle gets more than 80% of its power from glacier-fed reservoirs, and almost all of its water supply. The same goes for much of Oregon and just about all of British Columbia. And eventually, all of this meltwater will find its way into the ocean. This is the end of the Nooksack River, flowing into Bellingham Bay. It delivers nutrients that support phytoplankton blooms, which are basically the backbone of all aquatic life. And it changes the temperature and salinity of this water, supporting ocean habitats and driving the currents that move water around the entire planet. Even more important than the cool, nutrient-rich glacial water flowing into the ocean is all of the glacial water that isn't flowing into the ocean. Glaciers hold about 26 million cubic kilometers of water, or about 65 meters of water spread out across all of the world's oceans. Good news for the roughly 1 billion people living close to sea level, including many of the largest cities and much of the best farmland. Take the model we've made here in the Cascades, and you'll start to see it elsewhere. You'll see how meltwater from Himalayan glaciers feeds the Indus and Ganges river systems, supplying water to over a billion people in South Asia, and how glaciers in the Andes feed the Amazon and supply water to the largest cities in South America. Not all of the important impacts of glaciers can be measured. Each year in Peru, about 100,000 people trek to the highlands to honor a sacred glacier. Traditional stories in Ecuador speak of mountains and their glaciers as characters. Icelandic sagas tell of glaciers and their floods, and in the Norse creation myth, the universe begins from a battle between fire and ice. In indigenous stories from Alaska and the Yukon, glaciers are arbiters of morals, punishing those who act poorly by burying or flooding villages. A traditional tale from Switzerland tells of evil spirits trapped in the Alps' largest glacier, released when it retreats or melts. Maori stories tell of a goddess who loved to climb the highest peaks, and whose tears were frozen into a river of ice after her lover was swept away by an avalanche. Glacial landscapes inspired the artists of the Romantic movement, depicting the complex beauty of a dangerous and imposing landscape. Early Arctic expeditions included writers, painters, then photographers, and the ice continues to inspire artists of all mediums today. You've probably heard forests described as the lungs of the earth. I would say that glaciers are the heart, a vital organ slowly moving water and nutrients around the entire planet, breathing life into everything they touch.